I love this plane. Hello and welcome, dear skilled modelers, to my small hobby YouTube channel. My name is Tomo, and today we're gonna be looking at something very beautiful and dear to my heart. A Spitfire. This is one of the most sexiest planes that I've ever seen in my entire life. I love Spitfires, every iteration of it, and this one is no exception. This, however, is the later, very late version of Spitfire, the Mark 16. And let's put it up into its place. This plane is beautiful. It's from the company called Edward. It's a profi pack, which means that it has photo etch inside, and it's beautiful and gorgeous and superb. It's a 1/72 scale model that has around 150 parts, give or take. It has markings for 5 types of plane, and it has paint scheme for 5 types of plane. This is a clipped wing version of the legendary Spitfire, and is the 16 version of this particular airplane. So that means that it is a post-World War II plane. This kit was actually released last year, 2017, and it's a bubble top. Bubble top meaning the canopy, I'm guessing, because it's like a bubble, so that the pilot has a precedent view all around. As you will hear in a couple of minutes in this video, the plane was actually revised due to the necessity of Second World War, because the Air Force, the British Air Force, encountered the Focke-Wulf 190A, and that caused a lot of disturbance in the operations of the RAF. So without further ado, let us listen to the history, then open the box up, and then final thoughts. In September of 1941, a hitherto unknown German radial engine fighter appeared in the Western European sky. The new airplane was superior to British fighters, most distressingly to the Spitfire Mark V. The German design was soon recognized as the Focke-Wulf FW-190A. The loss suffered by the RAF over Western Europe rose rapidly, and in the crisis was serious enough that the RAF ceased their majority of daytime operations in November of 1941. The next attempt to resume this type of sorties was made in March 1942. Loss rates remained unacceptably high, and the RAF was forced to stop the ops once again. And all this was thanks to the Focke-Wulf FW-190A. The first response to a new German weapon was the Spitfire Mark 8. But the design changes were so complex that initiating timely production was not possible. In June 1942, a German pilot landed by mistake on British airfield, delivering a complete intact Focke-Wulf 190 fighter to the RAF hands. Competitive trials between the Focke-Wulf and the Spitfire Mark 5 began almost immediately. These mock encounters confirmed the situation over the front. These chances of British fighter surviving an encounter with a Focke-Wulf 190 were very slim. The only British fighter aircraft deemed suitable to oppose them were the Spitfire Mark 7 and Spitfire Mark 8, powered by the Merlin 61 engine. As mentioned previously, these were some time away for being ready for serious production. But there was another way of getting a powerful fighter quickly, by mating the Merlin 61 with two-stage supercharger with the fuselage of a Spitfire Mark 5C. Two Mark 5C airframes, AB196 and AB197, were selected for this purpose and were strengthened with modified Lingerung to accommodate the more powerful and heavier engine. The example was finished on February 26th and the second on March 27th, 1942. Flight trials were successful, and the order for serious production was issued almost immediately. Serious production began in June of 1942, and the first Mark 9s found their way into the number 64 squadron in July. Performance improved significantly in comparison to the Mark 5. A top speed of 409 miles per hour at 28,000 feet was higher by 40 miles per hour, and the service ceiling rose from 36,200 to 43,000 feet. The Mark 9 could climb at 4,000 feet per minute. The RAF finally had a fighter aircraft capable of opposing the Focke-Wulf 190A. Three main versions of Mark 9 were produced.
The F9 was powered by a Merlin 61 and was the only version of the assembly line in early 1943. The next version was the LF Mark 9, powered by the Merlin 66. These engines were designed to do its best at low altitudes. The third version, manufactured along with the LF, was the high altitude HF Mark 9 with the Merlin 70. The majority of Mark 9s manufactured were equipped with the so-called C-wing. Four 20mm cannon or two 20mm cannon and 3.3 caliber machine guns could be installed in the wings. From 1944, the strengthened E-wing was produced. Four 3.3 caliber machine guns were replaced with two 50 caliber heavy machine guns. In addition, bomb racks for 250-pound bombs were fitted under each wing. The Mark 9 became the second most numerous version of Spitfire, with a total of 5,653 examples being built. Mark 9 began to replace the Mark 5 from June 1942. Thanks to the new fighter, the RAF was ready to fight against the Luftwaffe over occupied Europe. Spitfire Mark 9s served with the RAF to the end of the war. In the post-war era, foreign air forces flew this version as well. Czechoslovak, Norwegian, Danish, and Canadian air forces operated numerous Mark 9s, and they were not alone. Spitfires would find themselves in combat again. Czechoslovakia sold the Spitfire Mark 9s to Israel in 1948, and these aircraft formed the backbone of the newly born Israeli Air Force in the fight against their Arab neighbors. The Merlin 266, built under license by Packard Motor Company, powered the next version of Spitfire Mark 16. The early production examples were, except for the engine, almost identical to the Mark 9. Late production blocks had bubble canopies and a redesigned rear fuselage.
So this is the typical Edward type box that it comes in. The box itself is pretty big compared to the aircraft that it's inside, and I really appreciate a big, nice box with a beautiful box art, and they really make the whole experience of opening up and the kit and on a shelf, you know, the presentation is just great. I love it. So let me show you. As you can see on the side, we have the five distinct markings and paint jobs for the plane. On the side. And on this side. Okay, so what do we see when we open the box? We have the colored manual. This is just the localized translations. And then we have the contents, each in their individual bag, which is nice. Some of them are grouped together, but you know, we'll just start with the first one. And we'll start with the clear parts. Well, the clear parts from Edward kit are absolutely immaculate. I have no complaints. Sometimes, okay, there is an instance where these stubs that are on the edges are kind of brittle and they kind of mess up the clear part. But if you do a good job of cutting them out and be very careful, it's pretty nice. Really. The main body comes in, of course, a big bag. Okay, the smaller pieces, these are the smaller pieces that go on the exterior of the plane. There are basically just wings and tail sections, depending on which version you're going to build. And the attention to detail is very good. You probably cannot see this by close-up shots. Sometimes I had a kind of problem with the lighting, but let me tell you, if you look very close, you can see all the little rivets. And it's not a raised detail, but as you go with paint, when you're painting them, those rivets are gonna pop out, especially if you're gonna use some sort of panel liner, and you know, beautiful stuff. Of course, the main attraction is the main fuselage and the wing section itself. So the whole airplane is not very big, as you can see. That's what I was saying. The box is basically very big for the model itself, but I think it's a more of a standardized thing because they put lots of different type of airplane into these boxes. Again, no flashing. Pristine, very good plastic, easy to put together, easy to clean. There's loads of fine detail on all the surfaces.
That again, you probably won't be able to see even in the close-up shots because you really have to get close and the lighting has to be correct. But let me tell you, if you go with the panel liner, once you painted this stuff in, all the little rivets and nooks and crannies will be shown out, and there are no raised details apart from this. This is like, I think, part of a magazine chamber for the bullets that are inside. These are the last two pieces of the sprue. And where Edward kind of impresses me the most is on the propeller blades in themselves. If you look close, they are absolutely sharp, no sort of, you know, overhang or whatever. They're so good. And the detail on this sprue is mainly due to the cockpit area, because you have all those wheels and pulleys and everything, and the, you know, the handlebar, the joystick or the antenna and stuff, and little bombs and fuel tank, and with the wheels that you have to assemble. This is kind of an interesting choice, that you have to assemble the wheels in this sort of fashion. But yeah, it is absolutely gorgeous. And inside like this cockpit area, it's very finely detailed, really. My head goes down. And even the engine parts, the exhausts, that you get, there are two types of exhaust, because there are two types of airplane. They're varied slightly, but you can still see. On one of them, however, there is a little bit of flashing, but nothing like a very sharp scalpel and a very steady hand won't fix. Again, the landing gears are a little bit different depending on which model you're gonna make. And the cockpit is, again, this portion here is absolutely great. There is raised detail on the instrument panel if you don't want to use Photo Edge, but if you do use Photo Edge, you have this one, so you can put those things here without any problems whatsoever. And Edward kits usually do come with a pre-cut masking tape, which is another huge bonus if you want to do a very good job of painting your canopy. And I've mentioned this is the Profi Pike, which means that it has these cool little Photo Edge parts inside. And again, hopefully I captured the detail on the close-up shots in the corner down here. And you will be able to see just the insane level of detail. There are not many of them. I mean, there are like 36 of them altogether, but just beautiful, just beautiful. Last but not least are the decals. Now, I'm not gonna take them out from the bag because I've already taken them out, and this is a piece of the model that's going back to the store on the shelf, so I don't want to really disturb them too much. But again, the decals are absolutely pristine. Again, very sharp, clear. You can, if you zoom in, and you will see that in the video, you can make out even the smallest text, which is just, you know, my hat off to them. Well, we have come to the end of this video. Boy, this kit is really something, isn't it? It's just perfect. I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that this could be tackled by just about anyone. If you are like a newbie, you can just skip the Photo Edge part if it's like too intimidating, and, you know, go for the plastic part version. But if you're like more advanced or, you know, intermediate, just go for it. It's just a great, great model. Anyway, enough of me rambling on. I want to thank you so much for watching. If you have been, please like, comment, and subscribe. Click the bell icon on the bottom of the video if you want to be notified every time I upload. I usually do my best to upload at least one video a week, usually on a Sunday, not a Saturday. I used to do it on Saturday, but because of, you know, summer and stuff, I kind of go to Sunday. And anyway, people have lots of time on Sunday, so it makes sense, I guess. See you again soon. Bye-bye.